Well, sprint cars are what was always been around, and you know, we knew the most about them. It was the best form of racing, we thought. And, you know, it isn't the super expensive racing that you can get into, but it's a lot of fun. We enjoy it. Man, I didn't work on the cars much. Dad didn't have them around here. He drove for somebody else most of the time. I just go into the races with Mom and Dad. Sat in the stands when we was, well, just 3 and 4 years old, I suppose. Well, I always knew I wanted to race. I watched Dad ever since I can remember. It's just always what I wanted to do.
Lou and his brother Bob are partners in a lumber yard in Hartford. His dad owned it, and they bought it from his father when he retired. His dad owned 3 sprint cars, and Dale Johnson, Gib Orr, and Lou drove them. It was always fun and exciting, and I enjoyed it very much. It's a whole new feeling having your son drive a car. Then your husband, when I married Lou, he was already driving, and it was exciting, and I liked that part of it. But to have your son drive a car, it gives a mother a different feeling. He is part of you that only, I guess, a mother can explain. The boys grew up with racing, and I'm glad I had 2 boys because they did love it and were always so proud of their dad. But I guess it was inevitable that one or both would become interested in driving a car.
Well, the engine doesn't sound real good, and I think after lunch we'll restart the engine and see if we can make some adjustments and make her a little bit better.
You started up before, it just sounded like it was too much fuel running through it.
Well, we can get her started again here after a bit. I think we can get that corrected. Possibly from, we had a different motor in last weekend. Maybe we should change the power and fuel injection on it to make it, and it's also cooler. Maybe we should just do this. Maybe it'll sound a little bit better. Maybe it'll run a little bit better.
Just change the power. It should be all right.
Well, we'll change the power and start it and see what it sounds like.
You guys want anything more to eat?
Nope.
No, thank you.
You're all done? Okay,
yep.
Good.
So I guess Andy ain't coming in town this week to race, huh? Guess he ain't got a motor.
I thought he had a motor after last week. Guess not, huh?
Must have scalped her somewhere. Did you go over and look at the new coupe last night?
Yeah, Dave and I was over there yesterday afternoon for a while. It's pretty neat.
Said it's pretty nice. I went over the other night.
Guess he'll have it ready if everything goes right Saturday evening. Anybody been overlooked the racetrack?
Banner, not full of it. Might be smooth. All that rain last night, that would screw it up pretty good.
Yeah, it was hard as it's been. I don't think the rain's gonna hurt it any.
Now, to me, sprint car racing is still the best. I've run the late model some, and I've run modified a lot. But the sprints, they're still when you get behind a wheel with Sprint, it seems like it wants to tear you apart instead of you driving it. It tries to drive you. And there's never a dull moment. They're light and they're very fast. And I've always enjoyed driving them. Well, I started racing probably 20-some years ago, around 1958, 60, somewhere in there, when we built the cars ourselves, maintained them ourselves, and things were quite cheap. Now everything's factory built. We're buying race cars, Travis Craft. All the good cars are all factory built, and it's changed a lot, but it's still a lot of fun. My son runs the Outlaw circuit now, which keeps him busy, him and a full-time mechanic. It gets expensive, but the money anymore, if you win a few, helps. Dave's went with me, you know, since he was old enough to walk, really. He's gone to races, and he always wanted to do it. He helped me on the cars. He worked on the cars. He took care of 2 years before he started driving. He took care of the cars himself, him and Dale, which are both my sons. And they knew the ins and outs, and he was always very interested. He wanted to drive. So last year, I just give him everything I had and let him get started. And he's done a real good job. He's got a good head on him. He thinks a lot, and he stays out of trouble good. Because sprint car racing is quite dangerous if you don't have the good equipment. Fire is the big problem. Anymore with the fuel cells and stuff like that, it helps the fire deal, and you got the good fire suits, and you can set in it for a while. Yeah, when he first started, everybody said he should start in a lower class, but I figured the sprint cars was the best, and Katie was a little against it, his mother, and the danger of it. I've done it for a long time, and I know the dangers, but he's got a good head on his shoulders, and it worked out well. He's ran a year and a half now, and he's hasn't been in much trouble at all. In fact, he's probably smoother than most people that drove for 20 years, and I think it was the best thing for him. And it's the sprint cars. He's got a lot of exposure, and there's people looking at him quite well now, so it's been a good deal.
Blaney Lumber. Oh, hi, Mary Gert. How are you? Yeah, we're getting ready. No, the car's going to be done. It's going to be okay. No, Luz is not going to be done tonight. No, I think maybe tomorrow night. You want more shirts? Great! I've got three here for you right now. Yeah, there's a beige large, medium white, extra large white. What did you want? I've got a yellow one, yeah. You want it for who? Billy. Oh, medium or large? I don't know. Let me see. This large one looks... Yeah, I think the large would fit Billy okay. Sure. Okay, I'll bring it along with your order, too. Okay. See you later.
Dave Blaney is one of the consistently fast qualifiers normally, not just here at Sharon, but at other places as well. And as we get ready for time trials here, it's kind of every man on his own. This is a time for just one car and one driver to have his time on the track, and the pressure is definitely on the driver at this point. The idea is to take two consecutive laps and try to turn the track in a time that will put you into the field. And we've got approximately 65 cars here, and only 30 cars are going to start the main event. And so time trials will determine, be a big factor in who's going to start where in that event. It's completely up to the driver, you know, the way he takes. He may take one lap, you know, a consistent lap. He may go all out and lead-footed on the second lap once he gets his first lap in. Dave will be trying to break Steve Kinzer's record. Steve currently holds the track record here at Sharon at 18.99 seconds. Steve Kinzer's record, and Dave will now have the distinction of holding a track record here at Sharon Speedway. Car racing under the lights gives kind of an exciting feeling, an eerie feeling. It's especially when the fans sit in a covered grandstand as this one is, and the lights are out in the stand. It's almost like a stage. And then, of course, the lighting here is excellent. So it seems like the drivers are really the stars on stage performing for you. And it just adds it's a little more exciting under the lights. Sharon Sprint Nationals has, in just 2 years, has built into one of four or five of the largest sprint events in the country. It's a prestigious thing, $30,000 and up is a purse, lap money, all kinds of individual contingencies and sponsorships and so on that tie in with this. It's a race that attracts drivers from about, today we have, I think, drivers from 10 different states entered. We have fans, the fan turnout, we couldn't believe that fans are here from Kalamazoo, Michigan, they're here from Canada, they're here from all the eastern states. And you never can tell, you know, this is a two-day event, and it's a good time for the fans, so you never can tell what they will be doing, on their Saturday afternoon while we're waiting for the second part of this big show. It's a Friday-Saturday show. I'm Has been making the trip into Sharon Speedway most of the summer. He won his first ever career sprint feature here at Sharon. We were real happy to be a part of that. He's his background in Hoosier racing, he's from Indianapolis, his background in Hoosier racing was kind of outstanding. He started in quarter midgets and he has been real successful there, but he started at a late age compared to when other people start in the quarter midgets. He started about 12. He's 19 years old now, and he was voted by the Hoosier Fan Club as Outstanding Rookie of the Year several years ago. And since then, why, he's been trying to make it in sprint cars. But basically, Andy's been trying to make it on his own. It's really a low-budget operation. It's his own equipment, and he maintains his own equipment, has no mechanic or anything with him. It's just basically Andy and his dad behind him. The Hillenburg race team has, they come in, and I guess what I would say is they come on just about the bare necessities. He doesn't really always have a spare engine or spare parts or whatever that the other fellows might have. So when Andy's here today, Andy's at the Sharon Sprint Nationals looking for a ride simply because he's out of engines and it's late in the season, and this happens to quite a few, even those with backup engines. When you come down the season starts in April, and so when you come down to around August, maybe even the end of July, everybody's running a little bit thin then, and that's when a sponsor or a backer or a car owner, you know, comes to your rescue. But in Andy's case, he's got the talent, he's got the ability, and he has driven for several other people, and he's looking for a ride today, and hopefully he'll be able to get in a car and get the most out of it here at Sharon Speedway.
I've been racing at Sharon Speedway most of this year. I really like the racetrack. It seems like it's just pretty downheartening to miss the biggest race of the year here. Well, I'm missing this race because my engine program really hasn't been too good. We've sort of been building the motors ourselves rather than take them to the guys that really know what they're doing. It seems like I've asked about 50 car owners if they'd just give me a chance to run their car for the Sharon Nationals. It sort of gets to a guy when his own race car is sitting at home and you just don't have the pieces to put it together. I grew up right around the Indianapolis Motor Speedway. To me, it's always sort of been awesome or amazing. Anything that I've considered, like my whole life, I've just sort of been working towards one goal, and that's to make it at Indianapolis. I'll do about anything I have to do to get a ride at Indianapolis.
The outlaw field that you'll see here at the Sharon Sprint Nationals would be one comparable to one of the outstanding fields across the country. Most of the drivers here are, the term outlaw is kind of used pretty widely anymore, but most of these drivers are basically trying to make it on their own just by racing alone. It's a tough way to go. Some of them sleep in their trucks. Some of them, you know, it's really hard to be on the road all the time. They may have four or five races in 1 week, and it doesn't allow for much else other than, you know, just take a little bit of care of yourself, but a lot of care of your race car. Equipment, you know, constantly has to be maintained and everything. Even between the 2 days of this show, you'll see many engine changes and a lot of elaborate work being done, or maybe even whole new cars being constructed or built. A racer's life, most of them are single, but however, the married ones, their wives have to be, you know, very understanding of what they're doing, because it's practically a 24-hour job with them. They eat it, they sleep it, and they drink it, and it's a way of life with them. They're here by choice, that's for sure. They're really hooked on it. Basically, that's the way you get the fans interested too. I always said if you could get a fan to the races three times, you'd have them hooked on the races, because by that time they've picked a favorite driver and they know their division that they like, and you'll find them cheering and so on. So I think if I could get a fan here three times, we'd have them hooked on racing too. It's a nice family type entertainment as families go, though now even more than before we see second generations coming along in racing. About $6,000 richer to Jamestown, Indiana, because he's won the A main event on the final night of the Sharon Sprint Nationals.
I've been building race cars full time since 1973. Previous to that, my father had the business and he built race cars for 40 years. He retired and I took over, and been building basically outlaw sprinters the last 10 years. Basically, a sprint car is a 1,500-pound open-wheel race car with an 86-inch wheelbase powered by a fuel-injected Chevrolet engine. They can reach speeds like on a racetrack like Syracuse, 140 miles an hour, and on a quarter-mile racetrack, so then maybe at 7 mile-an-hour speed, so there's quite a differentiation in speed. In the early 70s, if you wanted to be a sprint car racer, you went to central Pennsylvania, because that was a hotbed of racing. That's where Weld Opperman, Bobby Allen, Stevie Smith, they all came from. Well, Opperman came from California, Weld from Kansas City, Smith and Allen came from Miami, Florida, and settled in Pennsylvania to become race drivers and to really go to the top of the sprint racing, and that's where the original Outlaws started, and they all came east to race, and when they did, they had the best, most competitive racing in the country. They went all over the country and won the races, the big races, and when anybody came back trying to compete with them, they couldn't even compete. USAC came in Pennsylvania in 72. They ran some races. They ran five races, and Mitch Smith won three of them, and They ran one race at Sealings Grove, and the first seven place drivers were all from local Pennsylvania drivers, Adamson, Well, Smith, Lee Osborne at that time was living in Pennsylvania, and it seemed that's where they all started and came to compete with the big wings and the big motors, and that's where all the modern or innovations originated. The Trevis Craft name started in the middle 40s after the war, when my father ran a midget and built midgets and ran 7 days a week all over the country racing full time. And then he progressed from midget racing, died out in the early 50s, and they went to stock cars, and my dad went to Indianapolis cars, and he built cars from 51 till 64 for Indianapolis. And some of the drivers he had, well, the most famous car he had was the one A.J. Foyt won in 61 with. Was built for George Bignotti, and he won two races with that car, and it's in the museum at Indianapolis today. And after he had Dick Rathman and Pat O'Connor, Andy Linden, Mike Nazareth was a real famous driver. He drove all sprint cars, midgets, and Indianapolis cars. After the Indianapolis went to rear engine cars and the big factories and the big tire and automobile companies got involved. My father went back to building sprint cars, and at that time I was in high school and I got interested in and helped them. Sprint car builders are most often in the country are one-man shops. There's a few larger factories with maybe four employees or so, but basically it's a one person, a welder, machinist type of deal where everything's American made. Sprint car racing is American, and they always say it's like mom's apple pie, and that they originate around farmers, and that basically it's all a lot of the parts and that are direct deviation off of original tractors. And a one-man builder can still make a decent living. It's pretty hard to compete against some of the bigger shops, but you get to go to the races and participate as a builder, even though you don't have a car, and you follow the cars that you do build all over the country, and it gives you a lot of time to visit racers and to enjoy racing, which is almost a prerequisite to being a car builder. The biggest race of the year for the sprint cars, the Indianapolis sprint car racing, is the Super Nationals at Syracuse, New York.
I started racing about 8 years ago, and the reason I'm running sprints is mostly my dad raced when I was younger, and he drove the old modifieds. They weren't really called sprints, but they were kind of like a sprint car, and so I got into one of them right away, and we ran the older modified for 2 or 3 years before I got a first good sprint car ride, and now I've been kind of following this Outlaw and All-Star, and it's kind of neat because you can race where you want, when you want, and you don't have to follow any one circuit, and the money's pretty good now, and a guy can make a pretty good living racing if he tries hard enough.
I feel the outlaw racing is definitely, I guess, they're the fastest and everything. There's not too many rules, and it's more or less run what you brung. That's what makes them the fastest cars in the country, and that's what makes them the best, I feel.
It's mechanical drugs. You get your high by going 140 miles an hour down the straightaways on a mile. And the sprint car is just the ultimate dirt track car. On the short tracks, you throw them sideways and stand on the pedal, and it's just what gets us off. Traveling from track to track and trying to make the most money you can to support the race car. Trying to get a sponsor is always a nice thing, and we've been pretty fortunate. A lot of guys are on their own and just take the motor home and the race car and take off. But most people, in their life, they have some fantasy, something they want to do. whether it's playing football or just maybe driving a race car. And instead of sitting home with a can of beer and watching it on TV, I decided to go out and do it. So I got a late start. When I was 27, I went out and bought a sprint car and started as green as anybody. And after 6 years, we finally learned enough to go fast. But the Outlaw Band is a pretty close-knit group. Everybody helps everybody else out with chassis and setups and different things. And if you break down and you need parts, there's always somebody there to help you. I've taken off alone with no crew at all, towed 10, 12 hours away from home and pulled into a racetrack, and there's always plenty of people there to help out. So, you know, the thing is, if you want to do something in your life, just go out and do it. And if it's racing, don't be afraid of a sprint car, because all it takes is just time and you'll be fast.
I got started in modified cars in New York State originally. I was born and raised in Western New York. And my one goal in racing was to run the Speedway, Indianapolis. And I ran the modifieds for about 5 years up here and moved to Pennsylvania in 1969, where I started to drive sprint cars. And the transition was a pretty hard one compared to any other thing I'd done in racing. And the second year that I ran sprint cars, I moved into USAC. That would have been 1971, and I went out and ran, traveled Ohio every week and traveled back to Pennsylvania, which was a pretty tough deal. So 1975 or 76, we moved to Indiana, and I tried to run USAC two more years where their money wasn't as good, and the racing at that time was a lot of pavement and dirt, and it took a combination car, and it was a lot tougher deal than just running one with one race car on dirt. So the World Outlaws started up, and it entailed a lot more traveling, but the money was a lot better, and there was a lot more shows that you could run every week. And we, at that time, we were running 3 to 5 nights a week and probably traveling 60, 70,000 miles a year to do it. In the course of the year, we'd run 100 races, which money-wise and keeping you sharp was a lot better deal. So I think that's mainly why I got into sprint car racing and what it generated for today and what we're doing today. Now, in the last 2 years, we've run what they call the All-Star Circuit of Champions, which is a group that runs about 4 tracks in the Midwest. They run Pennsylvania, Indiana, Illinois, and Ohio. And we run about 60 shows a year with them, which is about 30,000 miles a summer. And the money is not quite as much as the Outlaws, but the traveling is about half as much, and it puts a lot more in your pocket at the end of the year. You asked me why I run Outlaw sprint cars. I think the biggest reason anybody does it, originally while we started out doing it, guys were running local tracks and they were getting in a rut. And when you run the local shows, the promoters, they get the same cars every week, you get the same crowd every week, and I think the purses pretty much get programmed to what the crowds are locally. And the money, eventually, in a racing, to make racing progress, you have to have the purses get bigger. And I think the thing that's made sprint car racing, or given sprint car racing the prominence that it has now, is the fact that we go move into different racetracks and run one or two shows a year, and they draw real huge crowds, and they can pay a larger purse. And I think that upgrades the equipment, it upgrades the class of the racing, and it upgrades the racers themselves, because the competition is keener, and the racetrack preparation is a little better for those shows, so the shows are better themselves. And I think the main difference between outlaw racing and running the USAC organization or another organized deal, the guys are kind of like one big happy family, and everybody's there to make a buck. And they realize that today is your day and tomorrow's the other guy's day. And if you need an engine or you need parts or you need some help, or everybody kind of gets around and talks over the racetracks and talks over the situation for that day. And everybody's there to help each other and to keep the deal going when we all make a living racing. where originally a lot of guys did it on the weekends, and they kept a car at a gas station and came out Friday night and raced Friday and Saturday and went to the lake on Sunday. Well, now we run Wednesdays, Thursdays, Fridays, Saturdays, Sunday. And it's a business, and it's not a game or a hobby anymore. So I think that there's a lot, sprint car racing especially, has a lot different, guys have a lot different outlook than they did on racing 10 or 15 years ago. And I think the fans do too. Before it was really a low form of racing, and now it's probably, it's number one action-wise in the country, I think, compared to any other racing going.
I'm kind of an outlaw's outlaw, or maybe an outlaw of the outlaws. I won't belong to a club that would have me as a member, but we pretty much race where we want to race and don't follow any particular circuit, and I've never chased points. So I might end up at an all-star show one night or just an independent racetrack on the way back from an outlaw show somewhere. The traveling thing is kind of a problem because of the expense of it. For one, when your tow vehicle is pulling about 6 miles per gallon, it takes an awful lot of money to get from one track to another. So when you're an independent and don't have a big sponsor or an unlimited budget, you have to be a little bit choosy about where you head. When we first started, we used to stay at the Holiday Out. That's where you park in the parking lot, sleep in the truck, and wait till morning until somebody comes out of their room and get there and take a shower before the maid comes. But now that we started going faster and things have changed somewhat, the Outlaws have become a far better respected group. A lot of the promoters will give you a motel room to kind of help things out. It's a difficult problem to finance it, and it takes a lot of people and a lot of help. The promoters realize this, and the Outlaws bring the fans bring the money, and the promoters present the race, and it's like a three-legged stool. There isn't any leg that's more important than the other, but it takes all three to make the thing work.
Through the racing, as I said, all the racers are pretty close, really. And the gentleman I worked for decided not to do as much racing this year as he had had in the past, and really he didn't have the need for a full-time mechanic anymore. So I heard that David was wanting to go out on the road and do some racing, so I came over and worked out a pretty good deal, and we've had a real good year, really. Oh yeah, you're going to make more money in a shop or in a, say, an independent business or whatever. It just depends on, you know, what you want to do and what you enjoy doing. And as far as security, I don't suppose it's the most secure thing, but what is anymore? I mean, years ago your factory used to be secure, but now that's not a secure job either. So it's just what you want to do, and you really got to, you got to be interested in it, or it's like any other job, you're not going to be good at it. You're not going to do your best if you're not fully into the whole deal. We don't work, say, maybe a regular schedule, because you really can't. You just have to, some days you may have to work 12, 14 hours to get done what you need to do to meet your racing schedule, and maybe the day following that or 2 days later you may not have to work but a couple hours a day, or maybe not even at all, but it all pretty well equals out. But there are a lot of long days where, you know, it's just not an eight, you just can't work 8 hours and say, well, that's all I'm going to do today and we'll do the rest tomorrow, because tomorrow may be too late. Racetrack. It's a racetrack that you got to have a lot of respect for, because you get the going a lot faster at the racetrack than what you realize possibly that you're going, because you don't have to slow down in the corners or anything. It's just, it's enough bank and enough of an oval that you really never slow down at all. And a lot of people get in trouble over there because they don't have any respect for the racetrack, and they get going faster than they're capable of dealing with, and in turn there are a lot of bad accidents, but most of them are due to the people not realizing how fast they're really going.
Outlaw racers are probably the toughest racers in the country. They don't get any tow money. They don't get they get nothing. They got to earn what they get, and I'm a firm believer, and that's the way a circuit should be run. You know, I've traveled with guys that if they put the amount of work in a regular job that they put in maintaining their sprint car, they'd be millionaires. That's exactly how hard these guys work. It's just a toughest business that I've ever been affiliated with. I mean, you know, you go, sometimes a promoter will give a guy a few bucks or if he's got a good name, but 9 times out of 10, you go to the racetrack and you run for what the purse is. And if you're not winning, of course, you go broke in a hurry. If you are winning, you can either break even or, you know, make some money. And it depends on how smart you are and how much work you do yourself, and whether or not you got a sponsor as to whether you're going to be able to maintain the pace of outlaw racing.
In 1970, the All-Star Circuit of Champions were formed with the original Outlaws, which, again, were Rick Ferkel, Jan Opperman, Kenny Weld, Van May, Dub May, Lou Blaney. We probably had some of the all the finer drivers in the country running at our circuit in the early 70s. I think most notable of our earlier drivers was Jan Opperman, and anybody that's followed Jan, he has to be perhaps one of the better sprint car drivers that ever raced in this country. And in the late 70s here, he had the misfortune of being very seriously injured out in Indianapolis. And for a lot of people that have read many articles in Stock Car Racing Magazine, different magazines, Jan was officially pronounced dead at the track. And I was right there and actually helped take Jan out of the car. And I zipped down his uniform and pulled off his helmet. He was bleeding very bad from a severe hit on the head. And he quit bleeding. And his eyes were wide open, and all of a sudden he started to turn black and blue, and he had no reflexes, no pulse, no heartbeats. It took about a minute and a half for the doctor to get there, and he officially declared him dead. They put him in the ambulance, took him to Methodist Hospital, and the doctor said, just take your time because he's dead. Again, just everybody around was shocked. Everybody was crying. It was really a bad scene. They finished the race. This was a 100-lapper at the Indianapolis Fairgrounds. Joe Saldana was the winner. immediately after the race, they announced that Jan was still living, and this shocked everybody. They couldn't believe it. A couple of us went out to the hospital, and the doctor said, yes, he's still living. So no one could believe this, so I called his the hospital room several times, and finally he regained consciousness in about a week. And later on, I talked with his wife and mother after he went back to Montana, and he started to recover. And he actually did come back and race that summer. I didn't get a chance to see Jan to February in Florida. So Jan and I sat down and had quite a lengthy talk, and I mentioned to Jan what had happened, and I'd taken him out of the, I'd taken his helmet off and unzipped his uniform and everything. And Jan says, well, you're not going to believe what I'm going to tell you. But he said, actually, he said, I was dead. He said, I was floating up in the clouds. And he said, it is really an unusual situation. He said, I followed the ambulance into the hospital, and I looked down and could see the top of the telephone poles and the wires and everything. And the good Lord talked to Jan, and he says, I'm giving you another chance. So if somebody had told me this previously, I just wouldn't have believed him. But I think that's a pretty well-known fact now, that he did come back, and he did very well for several years. And unfortunately, last year, another bad accident at Jennerstown, Pennsylvania, and he's now in pretty bad shape, so everybody is hoping for the best for Jan.
But it is a scary feeling sometimes to have your son out there, but I'm proud of him. He's good. He's going to get better. And he's doing something that he loves more than anything else in the world, and there aren't too many people that can say they're doing that. So it's fine with me that he's driving.
They call you the Bandit.